Welcome, Wisconsin, to the Maggie Dawn Show with me, Anya Esther. What you're hearing underneath me right now is a rare break from form. We usually only play women singers, but I thought I would bring you some of the audio directly from the march I covered yesterday, which is to say the March for Israel in Washington, D.C. What you're hearing are the Maccabees, an all-Jewish a cappella group, perform at that march. And about 290,000 attendees on the national lawn. Welcome to the show. My name is Anya Esther. I am filling in for Maggie Dawn. And today we are going to talk about the absolutely historic, absolutely people-moving event, heart-moving event, history-making event that was the March for Israel in Washington, D.C. Allow me to back up. Some of y'all didn't even know I was going to be gone, and that's okay. I was very secretive about this because, quite obviously, the security threat to Jews right now, to Jewish institutions right now, to Jewish events is through the roof in the wake of October 7th. Anti-Semitism, among many other forms of hatred, have spiked incredibly. And of course, when one is traveling, one doesn't want to be too clear about when and where they're moving, especially if they're concerned that someone who dislikes the idea of the thing that they're going to, someone like that may want to, I don't know, inhibit your ability to get there. We are going to talk about one instance in America yesterday where the decision to inhibit about 900 Jewish people's right to attend this march happened. But first, let's talk about the positives. One positive is that I was able to actually wake up at 3 a.m. yesterday to catch my flight in time. Myself and 120 other Wisconsinites flew early in the morning at about 6 a.m., out to Washington, D.C. We landed actually in Baltimore and then bussed into the security zone in D.C. We had a very, very quick boxed lunch and then headed out. And I broke away from the group to go to the press area. But those who I traveled with who were there just as individuals, just as not affiliated with the news group, then walked the further quarter mile to where they were able to get in, because by that point, at the very start of the event, essentially still, it had already become that crowded. And I say all of this with a smile on my face. I know usually when one talks about huge crowds and having to walk so far, it is said as a complaint, but I say this in awe of how DC and their security and law enforcement were able to handle such a huge crowd. I am in awe that things were able to go so well and so safely, especially when, as you're going to hear in the interviews I'm going to play for you later, there was almost essentially an expectation that at some point yesterday, something would go terribly wrong or there would be an attempt made to make things go terribly wrong. And I am so, 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 so thankful to say that is not how things went. It instead went very, very well. I want to start this evening by playing part of an interview for you. This interview was conducted after the march as we were all waiting back at the Baltimore airport to come back to Milwaukee. That's right. We left at 4 a.m., flew, attended the march, and flew straight back still last night. Just an incredible turnaround time for something like that. But this interview was one that I was so happy to get. I had basically introduced myself to the other people on the flight and said, if you are interested in having Wisconsin hear your voice and why you would choose to get up at 4 a.m., why you would choose to get up so early and leave Wisconsin to go to D.C. for something that feels like it's so far away. Someone named Dan came up to me. He actually said, after I invited people to come over and do interviews, he said, all right, I'll take the plunge. And I think his insights really summarize what a lot of people were feeling. Once again, this is part of a small interview with one Wisconsinite named Dan who attended the march with me.
My name is Anya. What is your name? Do you shake hands? Is that okay?
Sure, that's fine.
Hi. Nice to meet you. What is your name?
Dan.
Dan. And Dan, what brought you to D.C. today?
Sadness, anger, frustration, but an understanding that here we have this incredibly diverse people. We are diverse politically, religiously, culturally, every which way. And you would think that such a diverse people can't get it together. But I'm also a biologist, and I know that diversity is actually the strength in a system. And so too, that's what I found here today. That I found that, not in spite of, but precisely because of our differences and our diversity, we have this phenomenal voice, and that voice had to be heard because it's not being registered in much of the world right now. That it seems that the world is okay if Jews are victims. They're okay with us as long as we're the downtrodden. But when we fight back, when we stand up and say, we have a right to be, and to be who we wish to be and to where we wish to be, then that's not acceptable to people. And so we need to be able to have people understand that we have the right to survive.
Right.
And so that's why I came.
I'll have more with Dan in a moment, but I just want to reiterate what he said. Dan is a biologist. He mentions in his answer that he is a biologist and that it is because of his expertise on biology that he understands that diversity in a system is actually what helps it grow. And this was so true. This plane that I left Milwaukee on, again, 120 Wisconsinites going to D.C., a drop in the great pool that was the 290,000 total attendees. But that plane contained an incredible amount of diversity from folks who rolled up with Sani wrap still around their brand new tattoos on one side of the aisle, and sitting with them on that side would also be an Orthodox rabbi. And then across the aisle in the next seat would be a conservative rabbi, and in the next seat would be, I don't know, some other, someone else. I'm trying to think of other things, but I am still just in awe of the vast numbers of people, the many, many backgrounds of people who were present. I had the opportunity this morning to discuss on As Goes Wisconsin, specifically the comments of some of the members of the Muslim faith who were present, including Anila Ani, who was a Muslim Pakistani activist and politician who was one of the featured speakers. And her speech was one that echoes a sentiment that I think many people have and a conversation many more people need to have, which is the opportunity to consider if what people were participating in was activism, was helpful, or if it was anti-Semitism. And the same should absolutely be said for the opposite side, that what you engage in must and should be activism and not any form of hatred, be it anti-Semitism, Islamophobia, or anything else. Dan continues on with some of his thoughts as to where he is after the march is done.
Where are those? How are you feeling now after the march as we're gathered here in the airport about to head home?
I still have all those feelings.
Sure, of course.
But what I also understand, and today it made it very physical. As a Jew, you always inherently understand this, but to be able to actually be part of something, I mean, there were almost 300,000 people there today.
Yeah.
And what it means is that there's hope. And we can get through this. So I can walk away feeling I did my part, a little itsy-bitsy part.
Sure.
But together, we were able to create the sense that we're going to be okay. Eventually. It's going to take time, but we're going to get through this, and we're going to get through it together.
That's beautiful. Did you happen to have...
Dan's comments echoed a sentiment that I heard a lot throughout the day, which was this idea that we will be okay, eventually, but that things would still take time. To talk about time, it has been over a month now since this particular escalation began. Over a month since over 240 individuals were taken hostage under Gaza, including some as young as 9 months old and a young girl whose birthday is coming up this Friday. We heard from many families, family members, parents, mothers of individuals currently being held hostage. When we come back, I'll have more for you on this topic. The incredible resilience that we are observing in this time baffles and inspires me. And I hope to believe that we are going to be okay soon. Song that highlights this is Florence and the Machine, Dog Days Are Over, taking you to the break.
Happiness.
We stand here together as the yahrzeit candles for over 1,400 slaughtered in the sovereign state of Israel only because they were Jews. Sound familiar? We know that to lose a life is to lose a universe. And as we stand shoulder to shoulder, we transform thousands of our yahrzeit candles into one supernova of light and hope, illuminating the memories of those we have lost and shedding light on the murderers who brought them to their death. We stand here firm against global anti-Semitism. We stand here firm in confrontation of anti-Semitism here in these United States. We stand here to say enough. Maspek, maspek.
Welcome back to the Maggie Dawn Show. What you're hearing at the opening here are comments from actress Tova Feldshuh, who was one of the highlighted speakers, one of the main speakers at the March for Israel in Washington, D.C., which I had the phenomenal opportunity to travel to alongside 120 Wisconsinites. One of those 120 Wisconsinites was a fantastic rabbi by the name of Avrami. Avrami took me up on the opportunity to be interviewed by me after I made quite an awkward pitch to him to come over. I think kind of one of his guy friends coded him into it, but I appreciate it nonetheless. And his answers, I think, shed light on exactly what Tova is discussing here. What she's saying, a yahrzeit candle. Yahrzeit quite literally means year time. And it's a candle one lights in remembrance of someone who's passed away in the Jewish faith, traditionally lit on the anniversary, a year after or years after losing this person. What she's saying is that in light of, quite literally, in lighting of these horrible tragedies, all of us coming together, will create a form of light that can push out this horrible darkness of anti-Semitism. Avrami, as he will say here in his interview, works with kids and discusses how that darkness, how that hatred, he has seen it creeping into the schools and how it is affecting kids.
Amongst the many things that I do, I deal with teenagers a lot.
Okay.
And especially mostly kids who hang out in Nicolet High School. We have a Jewish teen house right next door. Mm-hmm. And since the war broke out, we come together and it's been a topic of conversation every time we get together, twice a week. And a lot of kids are in pain. I had a chance to speak to administration. So I feel like me coming here today, actually, I'm so happy to go back and bring back good reports that the Jewish people stood together, mm-hmm. are standing together. Mm-hmm. The numbers are tremendous. It might be the biggest, I heard a great line, it might be the biggest gathering of Jews since Mount Sinai.
Okay, all right.
That, I don't know if true or not, but it's definitely close. The fact that people are saying that, the numbers range somewhere around 300,000 people. Mm-hmm. So, yes, as the Jewish people.
I want to pause there and discuss kind of the beauty of what Avrami's just said. There is a fantastic phrase in the Jewish community where if you meet someone and you think you might recognize them because, you know, everybody is somebody you know's cousin or you met them at camp or something like this. If you meet someone and you can't quite place them, something that we say to each other is, perhaps I saw you at Sinai, which is a beautiful way of saying that in Judaism, there's this idea, I don't want to say myth, but maybe sort of like cultural idea, belief that when Moses was handed Torah, the Ten Commandments by God, all Jewish souls were surrounding him, basically. So the idea is we all bumped shoulders then and are now back bumping shoulders here. So this beautiful statement he's making is essentially that this is the first time this many Jewish people have been able to get together in such a way since the biblical founding of our religion. So just to give some context, you know, some of these fantastic statements by rabbis end up going over your head if you don't have the artist statement with them, I feel. So please enjoy more of his interview here.
That we're told, we realize that Hebrews say, "Be'ish echad b'lev echad," that we are one person with one heart. When our families in pain, we're in pain. So the fact that we're in D.C. today is, you know, even though I personally do have family in Israel, my mom's in Israel, my mother-in-law's in Israel, siblings in the army, brother-in-law's in the army, but nevertheless, beyond that, just coming here together as a Jewish people.
Yeah, just one.
Supporting each other. Going back to Milwaukee, I'm thrilled to go back and report that, you know what, yeah, we're a small community in Milwaukee, but the Jewish people are very, very strong and very, very resilient, and we're going to be okay. And just seeing getting strength in one another here in D.C.
That's beautiful.
I'll tell you this. So any loss of life is horrifying. Mm-hmm. Any tragedy is horrifying. Uniquely, this tragedy is, first mm-hmm. of all, on a practical level, almost every Jew that I know has known someone in Israel.
Right.
Cousin, family member, friend, French friend. It also hit home in a very weird way because we all grow up. I myself grew up with grandparents who were Holocaust survivors.
Right.
And everyone here, no matter if you're American, grandparents are American, or the Holocaust is part of our DNA. And this hit home different than other tragedies in the Jewish nation because of the brutality, so Holocaust-like.
Yes.
And I think it hit home in a way that it hit at the core. But why do we care? Because, you know, Jewish people are essentially one body. If your foot hurts, your arm feels it, and vice versa. So it's hard to explain, mm-hmm. but it's one Hebrew word that there's no English translation for. It's called mishpucha.
Yeah.
It literally translated means family, but it's more than that. It's something mm-hmm. that we care about. And the truth is, Jewish people don't always get along. Israel was not in the best place of getting along before it started. That's true family.
Right,
you
right.
fight and fight and fight, but push comes to shove. We're there for each other. And you see
right.
in Israel now, the togetherness is amazing. People who a month and a half ago wouldn't talk to each other, like literally, or even despise each other, who felt other people's ways of life are not good, have come together like
yeah.
family. So I think it's a family, and that's who we are.
That's beautiful. And it speaks to the diversity of Judaism today. Some people were talking on the flight over that we had to get a picture of all the rabbis because this might be the first time, and maybe, you know, have everyone together. Do you have any thoughts on the backgrounds that you saw today, how they differ, how they're similar to you? I mean, you've sort of said it through this mishpacha. I just didn't know if you had any more thoughts on that.
No, so it is... Everybody in Judaism has their own. Judaism, we say, everyone's on their own journey,
mm-hmm.
their own Jewish journey, their own mm-hmm. spiritual journey. But family, you can have one brother, one sister, act this level, that level. So, mm-hmm. but I think the reason why we could get together is because we're family. I think if we weren't family, then why do I got to connect to somebody who thinks differently, believes differently, and looks different, maybe, you know, and we're the only reason why I do that is because we're family.
Right.
So I think diversity is part of the Jewish people. Everyone's got their own journey, their own level, their own observance level, their own, you know, whatever. So it speaks great to the Malkin community that we all got on a plane together.
Yeah.
People from, like someone told me, Rabbi, it's the first time I've seen so many black cats and so many tattoos in one room, in one plane. And you know what? That's family. That's mishpacha. Yeah. So, we love each other for who we are.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I'm sure we have different opinions. If we had a debate on the flight home, you know, things will fly and discussions. But that's like Thanksgiving in most of America.
That's right.
So it's
that's
family.
Right. All right. Thank you so much.
No problem.
When we come back, I'll have more interviews from folks that I traveled with, and I'll also be taking your calls and comments. Feel free to give me a call, 844-967-2789, or utilize our text line, of course, through the Civic Media app. Super easy to use. Would definitely love to read something from you. In the meantime, we will return to a song. And of course, it is not loading, and I won't sing for you. I'll spare you that. We'll give it a second to load here. Oh no, of course not. Here we go. This is Olivia Rodrigo taking you to the break.
Okay, yeah.
I didn't want to have that happen today. I knew that in the scheme of what's happening in today's world.
Ago, my family and tens of thousands of Iranian Jews were forced to flee from the country they had called home for generations. In a moment's notice, their world turned upside down. Jewish leaders were falsely accused of espionage and executed in public squares. Jewish schools were targeted and closed. And Jewish families were forced to forfeit their homes and their businesses. 44 years ago, the Islamic Republic waged its war of terror and intimidation against the Iranian Jewish community. On October 7th, they waged that war against the international Jewish community.
Welcome back to the Maggie Dawn Show. This is Anya Esther, the producer of the Maggie Dawn Show, and I am reporting back to you after having spent, about 8 hours in D.C. and about 16 hours of travel around it, covering the March for Israel in Washington, D.C. I had the fantastic opportunity to travel to D.C. on a plane with 120 other Wisconsinites who joined the nearly 300,000 participants. And at this point in the show, I think it is important to talk about 900 folks who did not get to participate in this march. After I was done at the march, in fact, our group was recombobulating, as is the Milwaukee way. We were recombobulating ourselves post-march, waiting for the buses that would take us from our after-march location to the airport to come home. And something happened in that room that always makes me very nervous, which is someone stands up and goes, "Hey, everyone, I need to tell you about something that's going to make news tonight." And that is never it's interesting, to say the least, but it's not something one wants to hear when your immediate thought is who was hurt or who was killed. Now, thankfully, it was neither of these things. But the news that was relayed to us solved a lot of questions people had regarding some friends and family they had traveling from Detroit to D.C. You see, about 900 folks from Detroit, from around the Detroit area, chartered a flight. Chartered buses did exactly the same thing as the group here from Milwaukee and Wisconsin did. Many, many groups around the country did. Where theirs differed slightly was what they chartered, the kind of flight that they chartered, they did not go through TSA. It was private. And when those flights landed, what was supposed to happen, and this was normal, the security thing wasn't an issue, but it's a detail that will come up. When they landed, they, just like we, were not to deplane into the airport. Rather, they were to deplane onto the tarmac where the buses would be to pick them up. This is what happened for us, too. What was different is that when our buses arrived, we were able to get on them, and our bus drivers drove us to the rally. What occurred at Dulles Airport, when these Detroit folks landed, is that their bus drivers then, quote, found out that they were expected to drive these folks, largely, mostly Jews. I'm not sure what exactly the makeup of that 900 group was, but you can, of course, understand, largely a Jewish group. When the bus drivers discovered that their charter was that they were going to take these folks to a march that had to do with Israel, specifically being pro-Israel, those bus drivers abandoned them, got back in their buses, and drove off. Left the airport without them, as they were on the tarmac. Now, you'll recall I told you when they left Detroit that the way in which their flight was chartered, a private flight that did not go through TSA, they were now not allowed to get into the airport because they were not security cleared. That's a federal thing. So they're loaded back onto the plane. This is 10:30 a.m. yesterday. They're loaded back onto the plane as everyone on and outside of that plane scrambles to get them transportation. And the unfortunate story is that they are not able to clear transportation for these folks. You're now talking about trying to get buses to enter the sort of area where the planes are taxiing. That is how we were picked up as well. It's an incredibly high security clearance. And the buses who were cleared to do that left because they disagreed with the charter. They disagreed with the concept of driving people to something. They denied 900 people service, denied them the thing they paid for, denied them the thing they got up. They probably got up around 4 or 5, or sorry, left around 4 or 5 a.m., just like I did from Milwaukee. And from 10:30 a.m. Tuesday, yesterday, until 2:30 a.m. this morning, those families, those 900 people, sat on those planes at Dulles. They could not deplane into the airport. They could not get a bus to come pick them up. They could not get clearance for the plane to return back to Detroit. They were stuck on that plane for hours because a handful of individuals whose job it was to drive them decided they did not want to perform that task. Now, do I want to use the great big D word? Followed by the word suit here, discrima something, it's not my place. But I will be interested to see what the ensuing suits say about it. Someone who I had the great opportunity to speak to about this was a local leader, Moshe Katz. He was one of the people sitting behind me on the bus between our post-march location and the airport discussing with another person on our bus whose father-in-law was on those Dulles planes, on those Detroit to Dulles planes. And that man who was traveling with us, whose father-in-law was stuck, had been unable to reach his father-in-law that entire day. They had made plans that despite traveling separately, they would meet up at the rally, at the march. And he was unable to contact his father that entire day. Now, think of the anxiety. You and your parent are traveling separately. You're both adults, but you and your parent are traveling separately. And because of the callous, cruel, and frankly, and this is my personal editorial, potentially the premeditated choice to be assigned to drive people from an airport to D.C. on a day where an Israeli rally is happening and then decide as soon as you happen to be there that you won't do that. You make that decision question mark when you know that no one else will be able to come help them. Imagine that anxiety. I was hearing this discussion happen behind me on the bus right over. I was able to thankfully grab Moshe a few moments of his time. These are his thoughts both on the issue at large as well as the occurrence on the bus.
Thank you so much.
No problem, no problem.
Yeah. What makes this close to home for you? What brings this close to Wisconsin for you?
I'm, like many of us here today, I am, like they, unique. I've lived in Israel for a chunk of time. I served in the army. I keep an apartment there. I'm going there on Thursday. Wow. So for me, it's personal. And if you have any kind of personal contact with that, of any kind of life in Israel, everybody knows somebody who was either murdered or, hard to say, or worse, kidnapped or whatever. So there's that side to it. That's part one of the answer. There's a second part and there's a third part. The second part is, I believe, we ought to hold everybody to the same standard. So that when 5,000 people die here and 5,000 people die there, our focus of attention ought to be equal or at least relative or relevant to the people that it impacts upon. What's happened in Israel is, what's happened in Israel was horrific. The worst massacre to Jewish people since the Holocaust. It's been said 1,000 times, I hope they said it 1,000 more. I'm not minimizing what's happening in Gaza, because what's happening in Gaza from the civilian standpoint is horrific, but whose fault is that? From 1947 until 2023, there have been countless attempts at having some kind of a peace agreement between ourselves, Israelis and the Palestinians, or the Israelis and the Arab world. And the answers have been frequently, and almost every time consistently, no, no, no. No to recognition, no to negotiations, no to peace. That becomes personal again, because the third part of my answer is that either we should be talking about none of this, because it has no bearing on for the majority of us, or we should be talking a lot about this and a lot about everything else, and let's hold everybody to the same standards. But we don't. And my fear to that is, goes back to the first question you asked, anti-Semitism is still rampant. Today in Detroit, a crew came from Detroit to here to Washington for the event. They landed at Dulles Airport, and they, because they didn't go through security, they were on a tarmac, and their buses that came had drivers who refused to take them to where they were going. So they were left at the airport. Some of them are not leaving home until 2:30 this morning to get flights back.
Wow. 2:30 a.m.
later. 2:30 a.m. tomorrow morning.
Tomorrow, yeah. Wow, okay, yeah.
What is that?
Yeah.
Tell me that is not some kind of bizarre form of modern anti-Semitism. Those are the kind of things, again. And nobody's talking about that. There's no daily, hourly press talking about 240 hostages in not just in they're in evilest of evil hands right now, with no world pressure on it to do anything about it. Where's the Red Cross? Where's the UN? Where are all the world saying, where's the rest of the world saying, how dare we allow this to happen? The capital of every place in the world saying, let's get them out. They're representing 20 some different countries or 30 some different countries. Why is that not happening? Why is this not on daily news every hour on the hour? So why am I here? Because at the end of the day, if I'm not going to be here, who is going to be here?
That's very true. Thank you so much. If this gets into...
I'll cover up some of my own terrible floundering around the next question, but I asked Moshe to speak more on his experiences and why this was so close to home for him. He offered some incredible answers, including, if you didn't hear it in the previous part, that he lived in Israel through the Yom Kippur War, some of the intifadas. Moshe's done it all, folks. He's truly an incredible guy. It was amazing to speak with him. And now, from his own words, some more of that.
Dangerous place has become a very, very abused and misused type of place. I don't know that there's... I mean, yes, obviously right now the times in Israel are more challenging. But I lived in Israel through the Yom Kippur War.
Right.
I've been in Israel through the wars of Lebanon. I've been to Israel during the intifadas. I've been there through challenging times, so I'm really not afraid in the classic sense.
Sure.
And sometimes there's things we need to do that are of higher meaning. I'm going to hug friends and family. I'm really just going there, amongst other things. I plan on doing as much volunteer work as I can do.
Sure.
But I'm also just going to tell my friends I love you, and I'm here for you. Because sometimes sitting far away just isn't enough. Even if you go to Washington for a while like this, it's not the same. And I'm too old to do anything else. So.
Okay. You have anything else you'd like to say or wrap or?
Yeah.
Go for it.
John F. Kennedy once said, "Too often we enjoy the comfort of opinion without the discomfort of thought." A lot of us have become experts when our knowledge is very, very minimal. I am begging us all to either step back and let those who have greater knowledge prevail, or step in and get the knowledge you really need to have in order to take on the opinions that you do. Because unfortunately, at many of the rallies, especially those that are against Israel, people are extremely ignorant of what they're doing. This whole ripping down of the signs of the children held hostages, what rational place is that? How can anybody be taking on those images unless they simply don't know what they are?
Right.
And there are those who are claiming it's all fictitious. This is an Israeli made-up hoax. No, it's not. No, they're holding our children in cages. And the world should know that. And anybody who denies that is simply living in some bizarre world fantasy that they're not in touch with reality.
We'll have more from Moshe and from other members of the community when we come back on the Maggie Dawn Show.
WAUK. Listening to the show.
נער מים מתוקים במלח המדבר. בטח תחשבי שזה מוזר.
Years ago, President George Washington reassured the Jews of Newport that our new nation would give bigotry no sanction and persecution no assistance. His meaning and his message were quite specific. In the United States of America, the bigotry of anti-Semitism must have no place, no quarter, no haven, no home.
Welcome back to the Maggie Dawn Show. This is producer Anya Esther. And I should say, I'm realizing now, I didn't tell you who any of these lovely speakers were that I opened my segments with. I'm so sorry. My brain is so running on so few hours of sleep. But who you've just heard is U.S. Ambassador Deborah Lipstadt. She is the U.S. Special Envoy to Combat Anti-Semitism. I will note that her appointment to that role was delayed for a little bit by no one other than our good friend Rojo, but moving on. The speaker you heard before that was Ariel Mokhtarzadeh, representative of the Milken Institute. That was who was discussing the events 44 years ago against Iranian Jews. And before that, you heard, as I think I did say this one, Tova Feldsha. You may know her from the television series named Holocaust that had Meryl Streep in it back in 87, the film Kissing Jessica Stein, or more recently, I believe she played Golda Meir, Milwaukee native and first and so far only female prime minister of Israel. How much education can I sneak in just 2 short minutes. To wrap us up today, I have 2 interviews that I was so happy to be able to record. Two fantastic young women who I went to college with, who I am lucky to get to call friends, who I frankly had not seen, I think maybe since before the pandemic even. So to see them, to travel with them, to talk with them was wonderful. What will take you through to the end of the show here are interviews with my friends Chaya and Ali.
All right. So this is Anya Esther.
I should say, actually, as this is just rolling into the beginning, during Allie's interview, you're going to hear a lot of clapping and singing. Yes, this was recorded in an airport. Yes, this was recorded at 8 p.m. after we had been traveling since 4 a.m. Yes, indeed. But when you have about 120 Jewish people together, the party never stops. So what you will hear is a section of prayer that ends up turning into a dancing, clapping, singing circle. So hopefully you can hear Allie over all the boisterous joy, right?
Good, good.
Kaya, and how old are you?
I'm 25.
25. And you can be as generic as you want to with this. What do you do for a living?
I work in supply chain. I do global exports.
Oh, okay, perfect. And did you grow up in Wisconsin?
Yeah, I grew up on the north side of Milwaukee. I went to Jewish day school in high school.
Okay. Yeah. Would you consider yourself practicing Jew today?
Yeah, definitely.
All right. Yeah. And I asked this question, viewers, or listeners, you can't view this because this is radio, but Chai is currently wearing an Israeli flag cape. An Israeli flag sweater, an Israeli hat, and what is in your pocket is a string of smaller Israeli flags. So when I ask this question, I ask it to give context. So with that in mind, Chaya, what are your thoughts after the march today, and where do you want to go? When we get back to Milwaukee, where do you want to go from here?
I think it's interesting that you pointed out how much Israeli flag I am showing, because honestly, I have been really, for a while, hiding any obvious signs of my Jewish identity because it hasn't felt like a safe space for me. And so being able to come here and have all the Israeli swag that I can possibly have and just stand up and say that I am Jewish, mm-hmm. and I'm proud to be Jewish, and I stand by Israel, that can be very scary. And so just having the space period to do that, yeah. let alone having close to 300,000 people doing that with me,
yeah.
I think for myself was just really impactful. And I hope the world sees that, there was this was like a rally, it was a march, but it was so peaceful, and it was full of pain but also full of love, and I think that encapsulates the Jewish experience really well. Just seeing so much unity was so beautiful, and I would love to bring that home to Milwaukee, bring that spirit, be able to be strengthened in that. And
Chaya's comments really echoed for me something that I think we've heard other people talk about, which is this idea that despite all of the war, despite all of the hatred happening, our hope is for peace. I'm skipping forward just a bit because I do kind of want you to hear the incredible song dance circle in the background. This is a section of Allie's interview.
We do know each other, but I feel like I have to be more professional. Allie, as we sit here in the Baltimore airport, there is a prayer circle happening, there is laughter, there are people talking. How are you feeling in the midst of all of this?
Aside for truly exhausted, honestly, it's like, it's always really special to me to see like Jews come together in spaces like this, but it's even more so that it's Jews from all different sects of yes. Judaism, like all the different flavors are here and like together, and it's like we're all coming together as a family, and it's just really special.
It's beautiful. And in the lead up to this event, as the prayer circle grows louder and bigger, what concerns, if you had them, did you have leading up to this event?
I was really concerned about security. I know I'm not alone in like coming here with a lot of anxiety and just being super, super on guard. But I was pleasantly surprised that nothing bad happened.
Yeah.
Which is like a sad thing to be expecting, but it was just like, it was very nice to like be inside and then realize, like look around and then realize like we're safe and yeah. we're together and we're here. Yeah.
That's beautiful. And now we're now obviously post the march, after the march.
And like make it available to anyone that I can, especially like for me, I'm a college student and I'm really pushing to bring more education and awareness to campus.
Yeah, that's amazing. Allie, what thoughts do you have wrapping up here, if there's anything else you'd like to share with listeners or Wisconsin, or just say for yourself? You're welcome to.
I answer questions all the time, so as to stay curious and, you know, ask questions and find that opportunity for engagement.
Stay curious, Wisconsin. I'll see you tomorrow.
And entertain. This is The Shaw.
540 AM and 101.1 FM. WAUK. Your news, conversations, and a whole lot of fun.